From time immemorial, the tilling of the soil has been mankind's primary occupation. Poets have given dignity to the role of him who sows and reaps, the keeper of flocks and herds, living by toil in the sweat of his brow. The virtues of rural life are recorded in all literature, from the poems of Horace and Virgil in antiquity down to those of America's Robert Frost today. Traditionally abundant is the farmer's kitchen, filled with good things from garden, field, and barnyard. Popular thinking, a symbol of good living, health, and independence. This idea of the rural life as one of contentment and material plenty is deeply ingrained in the minds of most Americans. The fact that farmers have known years of poverty, of near famine and disaster in many regions of the United States, has not discouraged man's instinctive desire to live in direct contact with the soil that gives him sustenance. Yet so diverse and complex are the problems of America's farms that the Department of Agriculture, largest division of the federal government next to the Army and Navy, has made assistance to farmers its full-time business since 1862, year of its founding by Abraham Lincoln. Responsible to the nation, in peace as in war, for the productiveness of its soil and the welfare of the nearly 50% of our total population who live by and on it, the Department of Agriculture has offered much-needed counsel to American farmers ever since Civil War days. Today, regularly employed by the Department of Agriculture, are over 75,000 men and women, by far the greater part of them skilled specialists and scientists, whose main job is to help the U.S. farmer in cooperation with his state and local governments. Through 4 short years, from August 1914 to November 1918, America became the great provider of Europe's food and war supplies. U.S. farmers raised more cattle and hogs, grew more of every basic crop than ever before in the nation's history. Spurred on by boom prices, U.S. farmers mortgaged their futures to buy land at fantastic prices and plowed up millions of acres for wartime crops. Moving into the Great Plains, they converted grazing lands into grain fields, planted wheat where no wheat had ever grown before, and none should ever have grown. For this 4 years boom, farmers paid heavily when post-war depression brought bankruptcy and foreclosure to hundreds of thousands. But greatest loss to the nation came when rains and floods washing over treeless, grassless acres swept away forever billions of tons of irreplaceable, fertile topsoil. Thus today, U.S. Soil Conservation Service reports 100 million acres of land either completely eroded or damaged, 200 million more threatened with erosion. Completing the work of destruction were the disastrous years of drought, when wind, stripping the idle farmlands, made a lifeless desert of thousands of square miles of once rich territory. In the 1930s, driven from their homes by the marching desert, whole farm communities became landless wanderers, without means of subsistence, presenting the nation with a new problem. Thousands upon thousands of landless families became an added factor in the combination of poverty, falling markets, and unsold surpluses, which prolonged the worst depression in all U.S. history. And in the deep South, on land farmed for centuries, man's long-continued failure to put back into the soil what he took out was punished by nature in impoverishment. As a result, Southern one-crop farming has left 33% of the U.S. farm population with less than 15% of the nation's farm income. Grappling with the problem of proper land use is Georgia's distinguished native son, textile tycoon Cason Calloway, who feels that only Southern energy and initiative can solve the South's farm problems. At his 30,000-acre Blue Springs Farms near LaGrange in the Piedmont region of Georgia, Calloway is breaking ground for a new era for the South he loves. Here, bulldozers shape the land profile into farmable contours so that land wasted by generations of one-crop farming may be replenished by soil-enriching crops like Sericea laspidiza, a forage whose fame is rapidly spreading as a gully-healing remedy for eroded soil. Having chosen his land from among the worst that the South could offer, Calloway is also restoring it to use through such old-time U.S. crops as the scuppernong grape, prized for its wine since America's earliest days. And the ubiquitous blueberry, which has also been found to grow luxuriantly on soil too impoverished to support other crops. But major crop at Blue Springs Farms, because of its power to restore depleted southern land, is kudzu, a little-known vine imported from China. High in carotene and protein content, growing readily in eroded gullies, kudzu offers nourishment not only to animals, but to man, in the form of soups and vitamin preparations. Milestone in the South's difficult transition from the cabin and the cotton setup is Blue Springs Farms' dehydrating plant, first to produce artificially dried hay in the South. Kudzu, hay, and laspidiza are processed in 30 minutes from field to bags, thus saving all the precious vitamin A so frequently lost by traditional methods. Calloway's livestock, grazing on restored pastures, fatten quickly and provide natural fertilizer necessary to any well-rounded soil conservation project. Having proved by his 5 years of experimentation that even the most depleted land can be brought back into highly diversified production, Calloway is today trying out other operations, such as duck raising, possible for farms with small capital and little machinery.